All right, good morning and welcome. Come on in and have a seat. We are going to get started here. Want to just say, first off, if you're a guest with us this morning, welcome. We're so glad you're here and you've chosen to come worship here this morning, and we trust that you will be blessed. We're blessed to have you here. I want to highlight just a couple things that were up on the screen. First off, you probably noticed when you came in that our candy sales have started, the Easter candy sales, and all that goes to benefit our kids' ministry, to help send kids to camp and other things. So support that ministry if you would. Buy some good candy. It is very good. Trust me, I know. I've been stealing from Miss Cindy all week, and she doesn't even know it. Another thing I want to point out, you'll see an insert in the bulletin, says Young Adult Parents Night Out. This is not for parents of young adults, but this is for parents who are young adults. If you're 30 or under and you're a parent, we want to offer you a free night out. Well, at least free childcare for your night out. We're not paying for whatever you do outside of here, but we will take care of your kids. And you can see the insert for all the details, but we just want to encourage young adults, parents, to take advantage of that opportunity. All right, let's take about 1 minute and 37 seconds. Greet the people around you, and then we'll continue on.
All right. I love to hear the friendliness. You know, you guys can talk between Sundays. It's okay. You can't do it all before service. But I love to see the smiling faces and the joy. Is anybody joining me in thinking spring yet? Yeah. I hope the buds don't get nipped, as Barney Fife would say, with a little freeze here, huh? But man, every day's a good one, isn't it? You know why? Because we know who made it. And I don't know what you're bringing here today, but I just want to remind you that the one who made it, he's in control. He's here. He's attentive to every cry of our heart. So let's do that, open our hearts. You know, I know I can't talk to each one of you individually every week, and I know there's stuff going on, but I can't think of a better thing for the stuff that's going on in our life to come in this place and focus totally on him. Could we do that? How many think he's worthy of that, deserves that? So let's just put everything else aside. March Madness will drive you crazy. Just put that stuff aside. Whether Ohio State wins or not, that doesn't matter much for eternity. Besides, they already beat Michigan, and that's enough. I hate to break it to you, but I don't think the Lord cares the outcome of a ball game. People are praying on both sides, and it's okay. So let's enter into worship. I hope you never think that when you come here, and I know it's the heart from the platform, that we never just look up there and think it's Performance City. They want you to enter in. And we can't tell you how to do that. I mean, some of you do it in different ways, but it's inside, right? It's inside first. I think it can be outside and not be inside, or it could be inside and not outside, whatever. But let's focus on him. And if you need to stand, if you need to do whatever, you do that. We're not trying to tell you, get up, sit down, and please, listen, please don't ever get aggravated. We haven't talked for a while, so please don't ever get aggravated because you go, how long are we going to stand? Well, that's up to you. If you're done standing, sit down, okay? Don't gripe, and I don't know that you have, but just sit down. You're not being disobedient, irreverent, or whatever. That's what I do in a shopping place. 20 minutes in, and I find the nearest bench. Nothing wears me out more than that. So, seriously. And we always have guests with us. And we want to remember our worship is never about us. It's about him, right? We don't want to be a distraction. We want to honor people. On Sunday mornings, we have people coming from every background. Understanding, it's about him. Let's make sure we don't distract from him. But let's just let our hearts soar. You know, when I'm away like I've been, it just reminds me how much I love you all. Have I told you that lately? Have I told you that lately, Bob? I do. You go, oh, right, it's a pastoral thing. Well, I don't know. It's just something that the Lord's put in my heart. I hope that goes along with pastoring. But it's good to be back, and that's why I like to track you down and get a hug on you, because that way I can remember you're here. And if I run into you at Walmart and I haven't hugged you, I'll go, I didn't hug you Sunday, did I? And enough said. Oh, you should hear the excuses I hear when I say that to people. Well, I didn't say anything. I just said I didn't hug you last Sunday. But that's significant. And I'm so thankful for the warmth and the friendliness of people. And, you know, in our very group, again, some of you don't particularly want to be hugged. And I can honor that. So I said, you know, when you see me coming, get your hand out real quick. Hold it high. And that says, don't hug me. And, you know, people that greet each other, honor people. Don't get in people's space you don't know and put a hug on them that's awkward for them. They may not come back. Are you with me? Just a few housekeeping details here. We want to honor people. But I don't know how long that hand will work with me. It'll work for a while. I'll honor it. Okay. Well, let's pray together. Father, what a good day this is. What a good day. I love this place, this house. I love to drive by in the back parking lot and see the sun setting on any given day, the beauty. Your signature on the horizon is breathtaking. What a privilege it is to come to your house in this way. Brothers and sisters, from all kinds of different backgrounds, we come and we stand in unity. Not to do anything our way, but to do it your way. I thank for the warmth of these people. What a great group it is to pastor. The generosity, the kindness, the love. And it just is overwhelming. I thank you for what you're doing here in this very imperfect place. So today, as we offer up songs of adoration and worship, we sing songs that are old and new. May they all serve to just lift our hearts. And may we do as the scriptures say, delight in you today, Lord. May the words of the songs be instructed to our hearts. May everything that happens, may the words that's open today, may it apply to our lives right now today. We're so thankful, as we've talked and concluded this series last week, that we have an anchor, we have a hope in the midst of raging storms and uncertainty. And our hope is built on you, Jesus. We stand upon you, the solid rock. We love you with all of our hearts. We don't want it to just be a Sunday thing. We want it to be a daily thing where we live to please you, to honor you in everything from A to Z, all points between. We don't want to misrepresent you when we're in restaurants today, but we want to demonstrate your love to people that have to work. We want to be generous people. We want to be kind people. Even speaking the truth, we want to do it in love. So, Lord, I thank you for honoring us with your presence, because anyway, this gathering isn't our idea, it's yours. And we don't have to beg you to come. You're actually asking us to come, to be attentive to you. And so we deliberately, intentionally turn our gaze, our focus upon you. May your love abound on this campus today in every movement. May genuine kindness and love reach out in every direction. I pray a blessing upon every family unit that's in this place today. For everything that takes place, every song, every prayer, returning God's tithes, our offerings, may it be an act of worship, and may there be joy and hope in our hearts. And I pray all these things in the wonderful, life-giving name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Nate, here we go. Choir, good morning. Sorry I didn't get up there to greet you. So glad for you and your contribution every single week, and all those that you see and those you don't. Thank you all around. Let's worship him who deserves our praise.
And we know you can stand and sit whenever you want to, but if you could just at first stand up if you can.
Yeah.
feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song. When all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness. Do you feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song? When all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness? And we can see that God, you move.
A time of jubilee is coming.
A time of jubilee. Young and old return to Jesus.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom and know just what to do. Yeah.
as our God reigns. I see the clouds.
I'm not afraid.
Show me your glory.
Father, receive these songs that worship your majesty from our hearts to yours. It's a privilege now to invest in your kingdom, to give, yes, but first of all, to return. So receive these returns and gifts with your blessing. In Jesus' name I pray. The ushers are coming. Nate, I do want us to sing that new one. Kathy, I think you did it Thursday night a bit, but Our Father. It's interesting that you picked that, and that's kind of been a theme for a couple of things, because in the little mini series, sometime I was, maybe not today, but probably on the next service or two, we're going to focus on Lord's Prayer a little bit and how it connects with this and about Our Father. Worshiping him. So let's just do that a little bit before we open God's word. And this is kind of a newer song, but it's very simple. And you can't go wrong singing the Lord's Prayer, can you? When it comes from your heart. Let's open our hearts. Sing along if you know it, and if it's familiar to you as you learn it. That out loud right now, okay? Not say it, but let's pray it before they continue. Come on, let's pray it in the old King James way. Come on, here we go. Lift it, everyone. Our Father, which art in heaven. Come on, let me hear you. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Say that again. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And everyone said, amen.
In heaven, let heaven
Did you notice the beautiful worship signing? Don't we appreciate the deaf community and what they bring to our worship? Oh, man. That was gorgeous. Whew. That gave me goosebumps. Wonderful. Thank you, team. Well done. Well sung. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Don't forget that just around the corner, Easter's going to be here. Can you believe it? What is it? Sunday, is it the 8th of April? And we're not going to do exactly the thing we did with the 1-1-1 emphasis as far as making the big campaign. But could I encourage you to do three things before then? Could you pray and could you invite and could you pray? There's all kinds of people, friends, whoever it may be, they might just consider coming with you on Easter Sunday if you would invite them. We've got two things on our Good Friday night of worship. We'll focus around the cross and we'll experience communion in some form. It'll be a wonderful time. So bring people. We ought to fill this place that night. What a holy day of the year it is. But on Easter Sunday morning, we'll do something just clear cut with an invitation for people to come to Christ. Please pray. Ask the Lord who to invite. Invite and pray. Would you do that? And think about it. If you can arrange to get with somebody for breakfast early or meet them here or whatever. But let's just fill this place to the honor and glory of the Lord on Easter Sunday a couple of times. Okay? Got that? So however many weeks we have, they're quickly going. Our perspective and understanding is often so limited. Have you ever experienced that? Maybe like this week? In the King James Version, the Bible speaks of this as of us, and this limited understanding is only seeing through a glass darkly. You ever felt that way? Look at 1 Corinthians 13:12. First of all, from the King James, and then we'll read it from the NLT. It helps magnify it. For now, the emphasis is now. Okay, think about that. Right now, we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I am known. Let's read it now from the NLT, New Living Translation. Same verse. Now we see things imperfectly as in a cloudy mirror. But then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete. But then I will know everything completely just as God knows me now. The key really connects with what I talked to you about hope, the last series that we're moving on from today, but we so often view the world by now, but God says really the future isn't so much based on the now as it is on the past and God's faithfulness. That's our hope for the future. Because now can be so confusing. Now can be so cloudy. Now can be so partial, and if we make hasty decisions now, we might get it wrong. What I believe this passage, and I've been wanting to speak about this topic for quite some time, I believe these scriptures bear out that when God speaks and answers our prayers, it could be that his answer might be no. But I want you to see that when God does answer in this way, and he often does, it is not negatively, so I've entitled this little series, Positively No. It is still a positive response from God. Even though we see from our perspective through a glass darkly and we can't see it and we don't understand, it boils down to a matter of trust. Are we going to trust the one in whom we have believed? Are we going to trust the one we know from ages past, not just in our life, but throughout scriptures and stories of great men and women of faith? I think of the tension that no brings in various forms. And we don't have to think much further back than the recent tornadoes. Was that last weekend that hit in various states and claimed lives? And I'm not sure of all the places and cities, but I know this, that I'm sure that in the midst of those great storms, there were people fervently praying, because nowadays with all the weather stuff, we have a heads up enough to know to get on our knees and cry out to the Lord, right, for safety and protection. Agreed? And so on a positive note, we love it because you know the story, I guess it's of Nashville, where they were prepared to batten down the hatches for an unbelievable storm and tornado. And at the last possible moment, a wind shear came in and the tornado was neutralized and it never happened. And I'm sure there are men and women of God that were praising God at the same time to the north. Cities in Indiana and city in Kentucky were leveled, and I tell you, there were people praying and crying out to God for safety and protection there, and one city was spared and others were taken. Agreed? Have you seen the news? And that brings often attention in our lives. I'm reminded, too, of some of the tragedies that have happened. You know, we've had, what, three fatalities of horrible accidents, and in the last few days or a couple of weeks, and I know some of you have spoken about that to me today, and I was thinking about that because these kinds of losses are experienced in different ways and people react quite differently. There's instances, for example, when parents have literally pleaded to God to spare their life of their child, and we'll talk more about it later, and that's totally appropriate. But when children have died, and I've been with people along the way so many times when this has happened, but just a case in point, it's like one father would say and did say, I'm so disappointed and I don't understand, but I will accept it and I'm going to keep right on trusting God's goodness. I'm going to live for the Lord because I tell you one thing, I want to see my child again one day. But I've known of others like this, a father who, when experiencing a loss similar to the one above that I mentioned, grew bitter and actually renounced his faith in God, saying something like this: how could a God who's so powerful and loving and good, how could he allow such a horrible thing to be happen? How could my child be taken? And that particular man abruptly stopped attending weekly worship. He walked away from God and the church. There's that creative tension, isn't there? And I'm hearing these things, you're hearing these things from people, and I want to tell you that I don't have the answers for every situation today. I don't know what every situation is, but I find an underlying principle here. Listen, please. When our dreams and our hopes don't come true in this present time, in this dispensation, when we look through a glass darkly, when our dreams don't come to pass or our prayers aren't answered in the way that we would desire or convinced in our hearts that they should be, here's what I want to ask you. Can you take no for an answer? I've determined that in our culture, we're not really real good at taking no for an answer. And so we push to try to get our way. Can you take no for an answer, be it temporary or permanent? You remember the scripture I referred to last week from Lamentations 3. This is in a new context today, but I read it talking about hope. But you remember the passionate cry, I cry out, my splendor is gone. This is in the now. Everything I had hoped for from the Lord is lost. That's a now through the glass darkly, right? I've been reading through Psalms this week, and I was thinking about his lament, and I was thinking about the hopelessness that he cried out to and within the moment. The thought, verse 19, of my suffering and my homelessness is bitter beyond words. I will never forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. I talked about that verse last week, those two verses. But sometimes we feel that way. That's in the now. It doesn't seem to make sense. So I want to ask you, what happens to you when you're told no? What happens to you when you don't get the answer you want? Do you get an attitude? Do you shake your fist in the face of God and begin to question him? Do you turn your back on him and walk away in bitterness and anger? Are you choosing, in light of the verses I read, to live a miserable life that makes life miserable not only for you, but everyone you come in contact with in a contagious way? I'm learning in this sentimental age of mine that with three grandsons now that I've been blessed with, I love to say yes. How many grandparents are with me? Do you love to say yes? But you know what I'm finding? amidst a lot of yeses that I often say, I'm learning that sometimes I need to say no just to see what happens and how they'll react. Over something not so consequential, but just definitely when they have their mindset, sometimes I need to gently say no because I want to know what's going on inside of them. This little exercise I'm finding gives great insight, because if they can't learn to handle no now, they're going to be headed for serious trouble later. I give you permission, parents and grandparents, to say no to your children at times. That's the most loving thing we can do, and that's really where I'm going today. I want us to see that sometimes the most loving thing our Heavenly Father can do is tell us no. Is there anybody that could say, Pastor, from my perspective where I sit right now, I'm really glad that God once upon a time told me no? And you were so sure. But the problem is, some of you are in a situation where you still don't understand God's no. My question is, will you trust Him? Will you trust His heart? What's that song Dixie and I sang? Trust His heart. When you can't trace His hand, will you still trust the Father's heart? That God's too good to be unkind, even when He says no, even in the midst of His discipline, and He does discipline. Some of us like to hear about a good God, but we don't want to hear about a good God that brings discipline. I want to tell you, that's what good fathers do. I'm getting ahead of myself. Practical no's. When I write, I drive some of you crazy because I don't have a three-point outline. I'm a writer, and I write in sections. It's like a book. I have a title, and then I have next section, like, it may not make sense to you. I have this section, practical no's. So I ask again, how do you handle being told no? I want to say that often says a lot about your maturity. And I at first had spiritual maturity in there, but I scratched it out because I think sometimes it's both, but sometimes it's just maturity. Sometimes I think we just have a lack of common sense, and I think God needs to bless us with common sense sometimes, don't you? And sometimes we're asking amiss because it's just out there. Let me give you an example. My friend Scott is an assistant coach in the NBA Developmental League, and it's a relatively new league. It's growing rapidly. And as this new league has gotten established, they've literally had open tryouts at the beginning of each season. I mean, and here's how it goes. And one article called Hoop Dreams, about fantasy hoop dreams, brings this out. That there are guys who pay $650 to go to someplace in Tennessee or maybe Kentucky for a tryout, and if they make a team, they'll make $12,000 a year. Listen to this. One guy came out and paid $650 to try out for the NBA, and he was 41 years old. Interesting time to be starting a career, right? Another guy actually came from Budapest at a round-trip expense of $1,700, paying $650 in addition to travel for the team. Here's the problem. He was 6 feet tall and 135 pounds. Maybe God said no or equipped these gentlemen in such a way that they were never going to play in the NBA. And it was time for them to conclude that having an unrealistic pipe dream, it was time for them to move on and do something definite. Man, they could play all the ball they want for pleasure, but it's time to do something else for employment. You know, sometimes we just flat got to use some common sense. We're trying to play and pray and play some pipe dreams, and God says, I've given you this to enjoy, but that's not it. I've had people talk to me about pursuing a music career. Oh, my word. I said, first, God has to gift them the gift of pitch. Because I know they have the gift of monotone. But that's kind of funny, and I thought of that because it connected with Scott. But here's another more realistic thing. Listen to this, because I think this is where some of us struggle. A middle-aged man had always dreamed of being a preacher. When he was a small boy, that's what he wanted to do. He looked up to his father. His father was a pastor, and that's what he thought he should do. And he even went so far as attending seminary, but it just didn't connect. I mean, it just didn't work out there. And instead, he had to seek a new direction, so he became a very successful engineer. But he told his pastor, but the problem was when he was in church, a service like this, there were times when he actually felt guilty about not being a pastor. And there's probably people that's sitting in this crowd that struggle with something like this. And I hear, Pastor, a long time ago, I didn't do what I thought God wanted me to do. And now we can't enjoy freedom because we don't. Listen. In this case, God had blessed this man and enabled him to support his kingdom through business and all of that. But could it be that God had said no in that situation and he should just be at peace with the profession where he was and not second guess it and feel unspiritual? Come on now, are you with me? Because some of you are right there and you're being neutralized because the enemy's constantly telling you that you if you should have, could have, would have, might have, and here you are. I read an illustration, a story of a man who went back for his 50th high school reunion. The interesting thing was that this is the first reunion he had ever attended in his life. He said it was quite an experience because, if can you believe it, his classmates had grown so old that they didn't even recognize him when he got there after 50 years. Can you believe that? Throughout the evening, he reconnected with a lot of his old classmates. And you know, those of you who've been in reunions, you go, boy, I'm glad I didn't marry her. I'm glad I didn't marry him. You know how it goes. But I guess there was one gal with whom he had a connection, and he noticed conspicuously he was looking for her, but she was missing, and he began to ask about her, and he was told that she hadn't come that night, even though she wanted to, for fear that she would run into an old high school boyfriend. This is 50 years later, friends. And the person saying that said, you know, she never really got over him. He thought, what a shame, because she had been married to a good, wonderful, solid man, better quality as the years had unfolded, more than 40 years, all the while thinking she had settled for second best, and probably she would have come, he said, and seen that guy that she was all about. She would have known that she had done the right thing. She should have accepted no, but instead, 50 years later, she was still living in fear of something so trivial. Now, these may seem like light examples, but I want to tell you, this is where people live. How about this one? And I pardon me if some of you are engaged in something like this. I'm not thinking about any particular situation, but I can draw from my history as a pastor for years. Because there might be a situation where you're battling with the Lord's will over your children and one of your kids is dating somebody that you don't feel good about. It's not that you have a vendetta. I mean, you just don't feel good about it. And you pray and you do everything in your power. You don't want to alienate your child, but you try to walk carefully about it. Let's just say it's your daughter. But then your daughter goes ahead and marries that person anyway. What are you going to do? I have seen parents that won't accept that no. And they try to torpedo and sabotage a marriage when they should be throwing their shoulder into it by then to support, to encourage, to pray for the salvation of that spouse, to do everything they can. Are you with me? What happens when we don't get our way, when the prayer isn't answered the way we think it should be? When some dream that we have, we finally come to the realization that's never going to happen. I was a fairly decent athlete before I grew mature. But let's face it, folks, I'm not going to be playing in the NBA anytime soon. I have to accept that. Listen, sometimes God says no, and you can be assured that when he does, it's for the absolute best. Even though you may not be able to see it from this side, this present darkness. Oh, I love verses like this, don't you? I love them. I like Matthew 7:7 that says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. And knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives and seeks finds. To him who knocks and the door will be open. But the scripture doesn't tell us that you might be knocking 40 years, 50 years before the door gets open. Or you might have to actually go to heaven before the door is open. Can you accept that? Hey! I've told you about my uncle that my sisters, my mother and her sisters prayed for from the time he was a teenager in rebellion till he was in his 70s. They kept, and I got so tired of their seeking and knocking and the time it took. But one day he met Jesus and his life changed 6 months before he died. I'm sorry, 6 weeks. And the results are still having a ripple effect.
Are you willing to keep on? And I listed it, you know, in order. I put seeking and knocking and asking. Then that leads to finding and opening and receiving. But are you willing to be persistent? Or don't we love Psalm 37:4? Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. But when you delight yourself in the Lord, guess what? Your desires and His desires are one. You're not trying to tug a war and get Him to come into your camp and bless your mess. You're trying to come into accordance and alignment with His will, because the greatest joy you have is to live to please Him. Yes? These are great verses. They're verses that speak of both sides, because they must be presented because of God's infallible word. And we're instructed to ask according to God's will. That's what happens when we delight ourselves in Him. It's just not a free thing where we just grab it. We want to align our thinking with His. Asking according to the will of God. Yes, He's a good father that knows how to give good gifts to His children. Translation, the Father always knows best. Our prayers must be aligned with His will. So can you accept the fact when the Father disagrees with you and even corrects you or disciplines? Can you accept that? God's no. Yes, even when we are delighting in Him and we think we know and understand. No offense intended, but there was a day when I thought I wanted to date my wife's sister. This was before my wife, before we were married. Boy, I'm sure glad that didn't work out, because one of us wouldn't be living today. She is so the opposite of Dixie. Oh, my lands. Dixie's not here to hear it. She's with her parents. Some of you can pass that on. She'll be delighted to know that. But in choosing her, I didn't settle for second best. God doesn't always seem to give you the desires of your heart, what you think you want. His answer may not delight you even when you're delighting in Him at the time. Why? Because now on this side, in this moment of time, we're looking through a glass darkly. Right? Until sometime later, much later, and we don't know when later is. That's the problem. God's answers aren't always yes, and I want to say it again. Aren't you glad about that? God answers prayers in many ways. He says yes, He does, and He says no, and He says wait. How about this one? Does He ever go, are you serious? So you're praying, you're doing your best to delight yourself in the Lord, but you don't get that job, you don't get that promotion, you don't get that guy or girl that you were convinced of. You don't become pregnant, ladies. What if your child does not get well? What if your child is in an accident and your child is taken and another one is spared? What if you don't have the resources that are needed? How we respond when God says no reveals a great deal about our character. It also goes a long way to determining today where you sit, if you're living in satisfaction or contentment or total unrest and dissatisfaction and misery. You must choose, and I must choose. Could I tell you a story about Moses that I think we can apply to our lives? Numbers 20. The scriptures are usually on the screen, but I sure always encourage you to have your Bible, and you can mark in that and write things down. But let's pick up verse 7. This is a story basically of when God said no to Moses. And I mean, he was a pretty big dude spiritually, wasn't he? I mean, he's in the Hall of Fame. right? And God said no to him. Let's look at it. Numbers 20. And the Lord said to Moses, woo. It's easy to throw those words around nowadays. Moses knew what it was to hear the voice of the Lord. And God spoke, and so you got to know this. I mean, Moses wasn't a rookie when it got this place. I mean, he had been in contact with the Most Holy One. Show me your glory. You and Aaron must take the staff and assemble the entire community as the people watch. As they watch, not before they get there, but once they're there, speak to the rock over there and it will pour out water. You will provide enough water from the rock to satisfy the whole community and their livestock. Aren't you glad that God loves animals? We don't worship them, though, do we? We don't deify them. Verse 9, so Moses did as he was told. He took the staff from the place where it was kept before the Lord. I mean, this was a big deal. He didn't just pick up a stick somewhere. Did you notice that before? He took the staff from the place where it was kept before the Lord. You got it? I mean, this was significant. I mean, I know we think, oh, he's just looking around for a club because he wanted to smash that old rock. No. These were intentional acts. Verse 10, then he and Aaron summoned the people to come and gather at the rock. Listen, you rebels, he shouted. Oh, doesn't that just feel good? Because haven't you been sick by now of the Israelites complaining when you read God's word? Must we bring you water from this rock? Then Moses raised his hand and he struck the rock twice, by the way, with the rod of God. We'll say I've added that with the staff, and water gushed out so the entire community and their lives and their livestock drank. Wasn't that a good story? They're filled. But then comes verse 12. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, I spoke to you alone. I asked you to go before the people. I asked you to do it my way. Because you did not trust me enough to demonstrate my holiness to the people of Israel, because you did not trust me to obey my word exactly as I have spoken it, you will not lead them into the land that I am giving them. How many of you see that God told Moses the big no there? Did God change his mind about that? He did not. The children of Israel were complaining again. They were exercising their spiritual gift. No fresh water. They were thirsty, so they quickly turned on Moses, the leader. They began to blame him for taking them to this terrible place, forgetting how terrible the place used to be. They questioned his leadership abilities and all kinds of things, and they wanted Egypt in their hearts. This discipline, as I read this story, may sound quite severe because this talks about God's nature and holiness. It seems to me that it could be such a minor offense. How about you? That you'd almost miss it in the reading. But Moses was not permitted in the promised land because he struck the rock twice instead of speaking to the rock. By the way, I just want to remind you that you can't put God in a box because God seldom does the same thing the same way twice. After all, back to Moses, when they were faced with a similar challenge in a previous passage, God had instructed him to go and to strike the rock. Do you remember reading that? And it was fine. That's exactly what he was to do. So Moses was just repeating the process. I mean, he just glossed over what God said. He had sacrificed 40 years of his life to lead these rebels, as he called them, to the promised land. He'd practically carried them on his back when they didn't want to go. Wouldn't you get frustrated and exasperated? Wouldn't you get sick and tired of their constant complaining? Seems so unfair. Come on, Moses, you cannot enter the land of promise. You will never lead them in the victory march to that first city conquered of Jericho, going over those walls that I've knocked down. Where's the grace of God in all this? Oh, I know, this is the Old Testament, right? But there's a principle here. Look at Deuteronomy 3. And Moses is repeating and reminiscing. And it says, picking up in verse 23, at that time, he said, I pleaded with the Lord, and I said, O sovereign Lord, you have only begun to show your greatness and the strength of your hand to me, your servant. Is there any God in heaven or on earth who can perform such a great and mighty deeds as you do? Please let me cross. Please let me cross to the Jordan to see the wonderful land on the other side, the beautiful hill country and the Lebanon mountains. Please, Lord, I plead, I beg with you. 26, but the Lord was angry. This is Moses reflecting. The Lord was angry with me because of you. Well, I put at the top, there he goes, the blame game. But the Lord was angry with me because of you, and he would not listen to me. That's enough, he declared. Speak of it no more. God said, no. And Moses couldn't quit with an attitude. He still had to go on leading the people for a time. What would you do if you were Moses? I don't know if any of you had the experience, but I remember when we were driving in the car, our Chevy Biscayne or whatever it was, with wheels were the extra. You know, I mean, that's the only thing, like rubber tires, that's the only thing it had. All four of us kids packed in there, and I can remember we'd be bickering and all that. And whine and complain, and all of a sudden my dad would thunder, that's enough, not another word. Somehow I knew he meant it. God's word to Moses was final. It was final when he first spoke it. No, Moses, you are not going to enter the promised land. No, Moses, it's not going to happen the way you thought. I love you, you're my son, you're precious to me, but no. And this little series, we're going to talk about a couple of other Bible characters. Oh, it may sound harsh, but I don't think so. Theologians have different ideas about it, but could I just remind you of some things about this? No, and I can't justify it from God's perspective, but in my human understanding, I want to tell you that this breach of Moses was a repeat offense. And I'm not saying just because he struck the rock twice. This wasn't the first time Moses lost his temper. Are you with me? Have you read the story of Moses? Can you think about times as a young man when he probably flew into a rage and he killed that Egyptian bully? You remember? Do you remember when he came down the mountain from being in the very presence of God? He came down, found the people in rebellion. He went into a fit and he threw the tablets down that God had carved with his finger and smashed them in a fit of rage? Ooh. Do you remember the time he asked God to wipe the people off the face of the earth? I know he interceded for them another time to start over. But this time he lashed out in anger once again. He knew better, but he did it anyway. And secondly, this was a terrible example because Moses was in a place of public leadership. He was in front of all the people. You saw the instruction where God said, go and do this. More is expected out of leaders than this. I want to tell you, if you choose to be a leader, I don't care just a pastor or a lay leader, you bring yourself under greater scrutiny because of that platform that God has given you. If this disobedience didn't meet discipline, the people would think that it was just a trivial pursuit, this thing of God's will. I was uncomfortable, and maybe I've taken it out of context, you could say, but I was uncomfortable because it seemed to me that almost Moses took credit for this miracle when he shouted, must we bring you water from this rock? It wasn't Moses. We had nothing to do with it. It was all God. But you know, when I was thinking and reading about this, I remembered this, that here's where grace kicks in the New Testament. Have you thought about this? In spite of God's final no to Moses, and that he never did, although we know that God did put him in a place where he could see it, right? And God took care of Moses to the very end, didn't he? He gave him a memorial service like a few others. A private, wow. God was enough. But have you thought about this, that on the Mount of Transfiguration, who appeared? Who appeared in the Promised Land in that high place? Who appeared talking with Jesus? Elijah and who? Moses.
I don't know about you, but I think that's God's grace. Hebrews 12. Man, the minutes fly, and have you forgotten the encouraging words God spoke to you? Look at me. Have you forgotten the encouraging words God has spoken to you? God spoke to you as his children. He said, my child, don't make light of the Lord's discipline and don't give up when he corrects you. For the Lord disciplines those he loves and he punishes or disciplines each one that he accepts as a child. Athletes, it's not when your coach or student, it's not when your teacher doesn't get on you. That's the problem. When they get on you, that means they still see hope for you. It's when they quit. That's when they get worried. A loving parent will often say something like this, a grandparent, I love you, honey, too much to allow you to act this way, to have this attitude. God is such a loving heavenly father who loves to give good gifts. I alluded to that before. So when we rebel, he'll send in the hornets. That's one of my favorite stories. Send in the hornets. Look it up in the Old Testament. Read it. He sends in the hornets in order to nudge us and move us back in the right directions, and it's still our free will. Want me to sting him? Aren't you glad for some hornets sometimes? Parents, when you have to go to the pains of discipline, make sure that it counts where you get their attention. I read this story of Norman Vincent Peale. When he was a young teenage boy, he snuck out behind the barn to smoke a cigar. Did anybody ever go be out behind a shed or a barn to try a smoke? Come on, one. Smoke a cigar. That's a pretty tough place to start, isn't it, from what I understand? While attempting to smoke the cigar, he heard his dad in the barn hitching up the horses, and he thought, oh no, I'm trapped like a rat, but he also wanted to go to town, so he quickly snuffed out the cigar and stuffed it in his back pocket, and he came around the corner and asked his father, Dad, can I go with you? Can I help you hitch the animals? Can I go with you into town? Without looking up, evidently his father had already smelled the smoke. He saw him coming around the corner, but he didn't look up. He said, son, never make a specific request like this when you're harboring smoldering disobedience, because the seat of his pants were smoldering. Maybe sometimes God might say no because we're harboring smoldering something disobedience in our life. I still believe the Bible that says Psalm 66:18 that says, if I had not confessed the sin, that smoldering thing in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. There are numerous times in the Old Testament and the New where God dealt directly with that smoldering sin of disobedience. With discipline, it was direct, and God knew how to get the attention of people. My mom used to read me stories at appropriate times like this of Lot's wife being looking back with a longing heart, pillar of salt time, Miriam undermining the leadership of Moses, struck with blindness, Ananias and Sapphira, that's a good one. They lied to God and they were struck dead. My mom read that to me when I was seated on the kitchen stool when I had exaggerated the truth. Or Elymas, who was rendered blind because he undermined Paul's preaching. I know these are drastic attention getters and we don't see as much seemingly in these days, but I wonder if God doesn't often allow natural consequences of sin and disobedience to run their course. The seeds that we plant, they bring a harvest because we weren't willing to accept God's no, and in time we reap. The Bible still says, along with my mother, I thought my mother wrote it, be sure your sin will find you out. I thought my mother made that up. So could I just ask you a couple things as I wrap this up this morning? Maybe like Moses, you have some anger issues, and maybe you've not been in control of that or let God be in control, and you've shot your mouth off and your ideas, and you've lost something, maybe a job, because your attitude stinks. Or maybe you've continued to do things like smoking that aren't good for you, and then you're angry when you get lung cancer or some related disease. Or maybe you're sexually promiscuous and you contract some form of an STD and you're upset about that. Or maybe you cheat your way to the top, and when you get there, you're unprepared for the challenges that you face because you haven't paid the price. The Bible says again that a man reaps what he sows.
This doesn't mean, I'm not saying for a second that God doesn't offer forgiveness and grace. Listen to me, church friends. But you and I will often have to live with the earthly consequences of our disobedience. Like Moses, right? He died not too long thereafter, never having realized that dream. Hebrews 12:7. As you endure this divine discipline, remember, look at me, God is treating you as his own children. Who ever heard of a child who is never disciplined by his father? If God doesn't discipline you as he does all of his children, it means that you are illegitimate and are not really his children after all. Let me read on. Since we respected our earthly fathers who disciplined us, shouldn't we submit even more to the discipline of the Father of our spirits and live forever? For our earthly fathers disciplined us for a few years, doing the best they knew how. But God's discipline is always good for us so that we might share in his holiness. No discipline is enjoyable while it happens. It's painful. But afterwards, there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way. What? Trained in this way, the way of God's? No. Make up your mind. Don't allow God's discipline, his correction, to cripple you. Don't allow his no. Don't respond or react with a big no and walk away of your own. Allow his discipline to heal you and others. That's God's prescription. Every parent, maybe grandparents as well. Don't you love it when a previously disciplined child comes snuggling up to your lap and says, I'm sorry, and then they want to snuggle. All's well, huh? It's kind of hard to do when your kids are that big, isn't it? When I used to spank, yes, spank, S-P-A-N-K, my children, amen? I would then lovingly, and you can check with all of my kids, all three of them, in whom I am well pleased. You could ask them all if I did not gather them in my arms and pray for them and reassure them of my love for them and God's love for them and my expectations of their attitude and behavior, especially when Grandpa and Grandma were watching you. Ask them about that one. This is the spirit you want your child, your grandchild to have, and that's the spirit God wants you to have. When he disciplines us, and he will, when he says no, let's call this healing discipline, and let's receive it from a loving father. Is this okay? Would you stand? Thanks for your patience. Father, I love your word. I don't love your discipline in the sense that it feels good, but I'm so thankful that in your discipline, you're a God of love. And I know within the sound of my voice in the service today, there are people that have really been struggling because some of them are in the now time. They can't see face to face and know as they are known. But in the meantime, could we take a step back and know that our hope and our trust is in you as we've been talking, because you are faithful. You are a faithful God. Maybe for some of us, just with a lack of common sense, we're chasing pipe dreams when God wants us to be about the Father's business. Help us to be discerning. But more deeply in the throes of life, if some are suffering false guilt because they think they missed it long ago, may they rest and find contentment now in surrender and obedience to you. So Lord, apply this truth to people that are struggling, not understanding some tragedy. Some people are praising the Lord and thanking him, and others are questioning God because of a great loss. It's your grace and your love and your truth that can interpret all of those things. Thank you for your faithfulness. Teach us, Lord, even in the throes of this week of daily living, teach us to accept your word, your discipline, to welcome it, to apply it to our lives. And I pray these things in your name. As we pause before we're dismissed and we go to classes or wherever we go, they'll sing a bit. And if there's something that God has spoken to you about, if there's an attitude creeping up in your heart and you just need to get rid of it today, oh, you can find grace and mercy here. I can't tell you that the consequences are automatically going to change because of something done, but I can assure you that God will give you perspective. He'll offer you grace, and he'll remind you of his faithfulness. So before we go, could you just sing a little bit? This is our conclusion. When you need to slip out, that's fine. This is a place of prayer, a place to meet God. You can meet him anywhere, but now's the time when he speaks.
Abba, Father, my defender.
Lord, I accept it. Someone needs to just bow and say, okay,
you
Lord, I see
are holy, it. And I surrender.
For some of you need to commit to be persistent because you haven't heard weakness, it may not be a permanent thing.
You protect me.
I trust you, God.
When my heart strays, you correct me.
I want you to go with the truth of this little
I
song.
I cry, Abba, Father, I love you, Daddy.
I trust you. Where I cannot see, in things I do not understand, I will follow you.
I love you.
Way.
I love you, Daddy.
When you need to go, slip out, feel free to do that. They'll continue to sing. It's a place of prayer if needed. Apply God's word to your life.
Abba, Father, my defender. You are holy.
So
in my weakness, you protect me.